Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video and in the upcoming videos, we will learn about the semiconductor memories. So the semiconductor memory refers to the storage devices that uses the semiconductor technologies to store the digital data. So these memories are widely used in the various electronic devices. So in this video, we will talk about the one such memory that is known as the RAM. So in digital systems, if we talk about the memories, then we know that the flip-flop is very basic memory element which can store the 1 bit of information. And when we combine multiple such flip-flops together, then that is called the register. So if we have a n-bit register, then it can store the n-bit of data. So typically, the size of the register is in multiple of the 8 bits, like 8 bits, 16 bits, 32 bits or the 64 bits. So every digital system consists of several registers. For example, if we see the CPU of any processor, then it also contains the several registers. And these registers stores the data in the instruction which is currently being processed by the CPU. But as you know, these registers can store only up to the few bits of information. And we also know that the CPU consists of only a handful of such registers. That means the CPU needs a larger storage, like in megabyte or the gigabyte, which is fast enough, and it can also store the programs or the OS processes which will be required by the CPU during the operation. So this memory, which CPU frequently accesses during the operation, is known as the main memory. So there are two types of main memory, that is the RAM and the ROM. So this RAM stands for the random access memory, and this ROM stands for the read-only memory. So as its name suggests, this ROM is the read-only memory, meaning that we can only read the content of this memory, but we cannot write. So nowadays, the ROM which are available in the market is mostly a read-only, meaning that mostly it can be used for the reading the content of the memory, but it is also possible to perform the occasional write operations. On the other end, if you see the RAM or this random access memory, then we can perform both read as well as the write operations. So in this particular video, we will only talk about the RAM. So before we understand more about this RAM, first let us understand some basic terminologies related to the memories. So in general, if we see any memory unit, then it is collection of the storage cells. And along with that, it also consists of the digital circuit to transfer the information in and out from the memory unit. So this each storage cell in the memory is storing the 1 bit of information. Now whenever the information is stored or the retrieved from the memory, then these operations are carried out in the group of bits. And this group of bits are known as the word. So these different memories can have the different word length. That means the one word may contain the 8 bits, 16 bits or even 32 bits. That means whenever the information is accessed from the memory, then all the bits of the word will be accessed simultaneously. Now the architecture of the RAM is such that the time required to access any word in the memory is the same. That means if you want to transfer the information to or from the random word in the memory, then it will require the same amount of time. And that is why this memory is known as the random access memory. So all these words in the RAM contains the information in ones and zeros. Now this RAM is the volatile memory, meaning that the information stored in the memory will remain as it is until it is powered up. And as soon as we switch off the power, then the information which is stored in the memory will get lost. That means this RAM is the volatile memory. So now, let us see the basic block diagram of this RAM. So any random access memory consists of the specific number of words in the memory. And like I said, the word is the group of bits. So each word in the RAM will be assigned the specific address. For example, if one RAM consists of total 1024 words, then if we see the address of the first word, then in the decimal that is equal to 0. And if we see the address of the last word, then that will be equal to 1023. So in the binary, the address of the first word will be equal to 10 zeros, while the address of the last word will be equal to 10 ones. And as you can see, if you want to access all these words, then we will require the 10 address lines. So this 10 bit address on this address line will tell us what location in the RAM we want to access. So in general, if the RAM consists of 2 to the power k words, then to access these words, it requires the key address lines. That means the required number of address lines should be greater than or equal to log m to the base 2, where here the m is the number of words in the RAM. Now let's say the each word in the RAM is of n bits, or in other words, the word length is equal to n bits. That means when we want to read the data from the specific word, then we will require the n output lines. And similarly, when we want to write the data in the word, then we will require the n input lines. Now typically, instead of having the separate data lines for reading and writing in the memory, the same data lines are used for reading and the writing. So depending on the read and the write control signals, either data will be written on the RAM or it will be read from the memory. That means these read and the write control signals will decide the direction in which this data from the memory will go. So during the read operation, the data from the RAM will be fetched and it will go as an output towards the CPU. While in case of the write operation, from the CPU, the data will come towards the RAM and it will be stored in the RAM. And this data on the address line will decide on which location in the RAM this data will be written or the read from. So to read or write the data in the RAM, we need to apply the control signal, the specific address on the address line, as well as the data input in the specific order. So in the next video, we will see that how this read and the write operations are performed. But this is the basic block diagram of the RAM. So now, if you know the total number of words in the memory and you also know the word length, then we can easily find the size of the memory. That means the size of the RAM is equal to the total number of words in the RAM multiplied by the word length. So for example, if the one RAM has a 1024 words or the 2 to the power 10 words and the length of the word is equal to 16 bits, then we can say that the size of the RAM is equal to 2 to the power 10 times 16 bits. Now we know that the 1 byte is equal to 8 bits. That means here, the 16 bits is equal to 2 bytes. So we can say that the size of the memory is equal to 2 to the power 10 times 2 bytes. That is equal to 2 kilobytes. So typically in the memories, or in general in the digital systems, this 2 to the power 10 is shown by the symbol K, and that corresponds to kilo. Likewise, this 2 to the power 20 is shown by the symbol M, and that corresponds to mega. And likewise, this 2 to the power 30 is shown by the symbol G, which corresponds to the giga. That means in this case, the size of the RAM is equal to 2 kilobyte. So similarly, in another RAM, if the total number of words is equal to 2 times 2 to the power 20 and the word length is equal to 32 bits, then the size of the RAM is equal to 2 times 2 to the power 20 words times 32 bits. Now we know that the 1 byte is equal to 8 bits. That means here, this 32 bits corresponds to 4 bytes. And we know that this 2 to the power 20 corresponds to M. So we can say that the total size of the RAM is equal to 8 megabytes. So in this way, we can easily find the size of any RAM. Now so far we have seen that by applying a particular address on the address line, we can access the specific word in the memory. But actually, we also need a digital circuit which will accept this address as an input, and based on that input, it will select the specific word in the memory. So here for that, we will require a decoder for the address decoding. So in this decoder, we will apply the k-bit address, and based on that address, it will select the specific word in the memory. So in the next video, we will talk more about this address decoding. And with the help of the timing diagram, we will also understand how the read and the write operations are performed in the RAM. But I hope in this video, you understood the basics of the random access memory. So if you have any question or suggestion, then do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.